Right, colleagues, before we do resume the debate, could I provide a further clarification? I have been advised that actually there is a problem with the World Wide Web, and therefore we obviously need to, along with, I'm guessing, much of the rest of the world, investigate what is happening, why it's happening, and when it can be fixed. Obviously, there will be implications, I would imagine, for later in the afternoon. Please rest assured that those are currently being actively looked into by the Chief Exec's office, and further information will be provided when that is available so that members know exactly what will be happening in terms of any deferral of decision time or whatever is the best way forward. But in the meantime, I would like for us to continue with the debate. And I know I have to now call Liam MacArthur up to 4 minutes, please, Mr MacArthur.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I thank you and indeed Liz Smith for trying to maximise the online viewing ratings for my speech. I will try not to disappoint. There's clearly a sense of Groundhog Day. We seem to have been having this debate in some guise on a weekly basis, one way or another. And I certainly don't begrudge that, given the urgency of the climate emergency, nor indeed the importance of ensuring a just transition, one that, as my amendment and as Colin Smith set out in his speech, but in my amendment to this debate, sought to reinforce, needs to secure the future of workers and communities and deliver tens of thousands of good green jobs. So I thank Liam Kerr for his motion, which on the face of it doesn't seem unreasonable, though I'm not entirely clear how far short of maximum extraction it would leave us. We need to accept, I believe, that some of that resource will have to be left in the ground. Even so, it is worth taking a moment to reflect on the current contribution of the oil and gas sector. Economically significant, there is no doubt, both in terms of gross value added, but also in terms of jobs right across the country. The North East, perhaps more significantly, but in proportionate terms, I would argue, in the Highlands and Islands to no lesser extent, further adding weight to the argument for specific attention to be made to a just transition in that region. The UK Climate Change Committee, as Liam Kerr acknowledged, all of their scenarios anticipate oil and gas accounting for up to or around 50% of total cumulative energy demand up to 2050. This may reflect a marked reduction on where we are now, but it remains significant. It also underlines the need both to bear down on demand as well as avoid simply displacing domestic production with imports of higher environmentally impactful and more problematic security supplies. At the same time, those working in the oil and gas sector do, I think, recognise the need for an energy transition. Recent polling, indeed, appears to suggest that there's a real appetite amongst those working in the sector to see that transition take place. But I think the importance on government and for its agencies is to make that as easy as possible. There's an obvious read across to the needs of the renewable energy sector, but I think it would be overly simplistic to simply say that that's where the transition will go. There will be many other sectors that can take advantage of the skills of those within the oil and gas sector. And as I say, it's incumbent upon government and agencies to do more, both to raise awareness of options, but also to make that transfer, including any retraining or skills development needed, as smooth as possible. We'll happily support the amendment in Colin Smith's name. I'm slightly more reluctant in relation to Michael Matheson's amendment. For the record, Scottish Liberal Democrats certainly do not at this stage welcome the Scottish budget, not just because it clobbers local authorities across the country. It also, I think, falls short of helping us meet our climate objectives. Questions have already been raised about what the £500 million Energy Transition Fund is actually made up of and whether this will turn out to be more smoke and mirrors. It would be helpful in that context, perhaps, if the Minister or the Cabinet Secretary might be able to set out the year one objectives for the £20 million referred to, how many workers will actually benefit and what the predicted investments are in future years. In the context of the UK Climate Change Committee's recent criticism of the Scottish Government over the lack of detail on plans to achieve net zero, I think these and other questions become ever more crucial and ever more central. Presiding Officer, as I've said in the context of previous debates, key to a just transition is the creation of new green jobs. We've had the promises before, but we cannot afford now to leave people and communities behind. However, achieving that will require those plans to be both radical but also credible. We need to bring people with us, and that, I think, will rest heavily on credibility, and including those who are in the oil and gas sector. Change is unavoidable, but only with detailed plans and proper resourcing can there be any hope of achieving this in a managed way. Thank you very much, President Officer.
Thank you. And we now move to the open debate, and I call Maurice Golden to be followed by Paul McLennan. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There are now two distinct visions of the North Sea's future. On the one hand, we have the potential for a just transition, ushering in a new age of prosperity for Scotland. Decommissioning will play a central role, with up to £50 billion invested in the North Sea by 2040. The potential is there to support thousands of jobs, either directly or through supply chains. Jobs that oil and gas workers are well placed to fill, given their highly transferable skill sets. But we need a circular economy to properly tap this potential. For example, why scrap a pipeline when it's worth five times as much in the construction sector? And together, improved reuse, better remanufacturing and higher value recycling could increase the value of assets such as steel, valves, vessels and tanks by as much as 25%. Alongside a digital tracking system for new or replacement assets, say through QR codes, we can ensure we extract as much of that value as possible. We should also be capitalising on the huge steel smelting potential. Typically, 94% of oil and gas platform steel is smelted, so an electric arc furnace in Scotland makes perfect sense to help recycle the estimated 5.5 million tonnes of steel available on the UK continental shelf. It would create skilled jobs, reduce carbon impacts and lower constraint payments. And once again, I urge the government to explore this opportunity. All this requires close cooperation with the oil and gas sector. And it makes sense that we do, because even the UK Committee on Climate Change forecast oil and gas will continue to provide up to 50% of our energy demand out to 2050. So, the sensible approach is ensuring the industry has the minimal impact possible on the environment. That's why the North Sea Transition Deal is focused on reducing production emissions, which will get a boost from UK plans to quadruple offshore wind generation, making electrification of oil and gas platforms easier by tying them to that offshore generation. Set against our sensible and sustainable vision is the extreme position the Greens are pushing. They want North Sea oil and gas shut down as quickly as possible. One of their ministers called for a shutdown to start next year. Meanwhile, the other openly celebrates Scottish oil and gas jobs being put at risk. It's the stuff of student politics, treating the oil and gas sector as an enemy and their workers as an afterthought. And the SNP seem happy to go along with this approach. They show no sign of putting in the work needed. Still, no circular economy bill, years late. No industrial roadmap, which is critical for CCS. And no word on Scottish offshore floating wind getting the support they need to compete. The Scottish Government has set an arbitrary limit of 100 megawatts for Scottish projects, and they are expecting that to compete with the 300 megawatt projects throughout the rest of the United Kingdom. But the failures are mounting even further. Emissions targets failed, recycling targets failed, green jobs target failed, and they can't even deliver a 1990s deposit return scheme after working on it for a decade. So let's remember 100,000 jobs depend on the oil and gas sector. Those workers need certainty for the future, and I know which of our two visions they trust to deliver it.
Thank you. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Michael Mara. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This morning I held a joint meeting with Scottish Renewables and the Scottish Cluster. At that meeting, we looked at opportunities for both sectors regarding the supply chain, encouraging local supply chain development, manufacturing opportunities and developing a skilled workforce, working with local skills agencies, colleges and universities. I also know, following discussions with Oil and Gas UK, they are keen to engage with both the Scottish cluster and the renewable sector in this regard. The costs of retrofitting properties in Scotland are also estimated to be around about £33 billion, according to a study by Glasgow University. With our 2% population share in my East Lothian constituency, that would be around about £750 million alone in that sector. Last week in the Scottish Government Net Zero debate, I touched on a recent meeting with Scottish Renewables with SNP colleagues, where we heard of the opportunities of the renewable sector in delivering an additional 17,000 jobs with an additional £33 billion of GVA by 2030. In that same debate, I mentioned in a recent report by Robert Gordon University, stated that 90% of oil and gas industry jobs have medium to high transferability into green and net zero industries. I've only got 4 minutes, so I want to get through the speech. I have points to make. No, I want to, get through. There are opportunities to work with all sectors together. The Scottish Cluster also recently published the key findings of a report on the employment impact of the Scottish Cluster in Scotland. The report was commissioned by Storega, the lead developer of the Acorn project, on behalf of the Scottish Cluster. The Scottish Cluster then found out it could support an average of 15,100 jobs between 2022 and 2050, comprising 6,200 direct jobs and 8,900 supply chain jobs. Today, total Scottish Cluster jobs were expected to peak at 20,600 in 2031. If the UK Government had accepted Projectors Track 1, this would have started supporting jobs as early as 2022. No, I'm sorry, I've got time to get through. I've only got 4 minutes. The initial project build phase would have supported 15,000 jobs straight away. So I ask this question, who's letting the North East down now? This would have been bad enough, but the Conservatives' shambolic handling of the Peterhead CCS project in 2015 just adds insult to injury. No. Only this week, Professor.
Excuse me, gentlemen. I think the member has indicated now quite a few times that he's not giving way, and it's up to each member, as you know, to decide whether they're taking intervention or not. Please resume, Ms. McLennan.
I think the truth is making an impact there, Presiding Officer. Only this week, Professor Stuart Hazeldine, carbon capture and storage expert at the University of Edinburgh, said there is no advantage in the project selection as a reserved bidder. No advantage. Sorry, no. You also said that carbon capture projects are fundamental to Scotland meeting its net zero targets by 2045. And he also stated it just means you have to go a lot of meetings where there's very little chance of one of the other bidders being declared void. So you're effectively being asked to run on the spot with very little or no funding, and that's a direct quote. So I'll ask again, who's letting the North East down? The Tories. No, I'm sorry, I'm not taking any interventions. Scottish Government is investing heavily in the area. £62 million Energy Transition Fund will support an energy sector in the North East, help make significant progress in energy transition as we move towards a net zero society by 2045. The £500 million Energy Transition Fund will protect existing jobs and create new jobs in the North East and across Scotland by opening up opportunities through energy transition and harnessing private sector funding. The Scottish Government has already announced £26 million for the Energy Transition Zone, £16.5 million for the NZTTP, £6.5 million for a Global Underwater Hub and £4.65 million to the Aberdeen Hydrogen Hub. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, this isn't an either-or discussion. It isn't an either-or discussion. We can manage a just transition working with all sectors. The Tories need to move on from that narrative. You need to move on. The Scottish Government is wholly committed to ending Scotland's contribution to climate change by 2045. And to ensuring we do that in a way that is just and leaves no one behind. The Scottish Government is committed to supporting the North East of Scotland and is determined to secure a just transition for the region and all of its workers. The Scottish Government will not allow the mistakes of the past to be repeated. Indeed, far from deserting the sector, the Scottish Government are already investing in its net zero transformation. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Michael Mara to be followed by Mark Ruscoe. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There is no greater issue of importance to the people I represent than the future of the economy of the North East and the livelihoods that depend upon it. So this is about jobs, wages and our taxes. The deeply worrying income tax receipts presented by the Finance Secretary last week can be, in part, traced to the low oil price and the decline of North Sea exploration. So it is the public finances and our public services too. Scottish Labour believes the only viable transition is a jobs-first transition where opportunity remains for our communities. We believe that the skills and infrastructure in the North East will be vital to any realistic transition to a low-carbon economy, but we do not underestimate the scale of the challenge. If there is a good example where such a fundamental change has been achieved since the Industrial Revolution without significant pain, then I'm still to see it. When I read words from colleagues in other parties in recent days about a jobs-rich future, I have to say I am sceptical. And that's on the basis, I'm afraid, of experience. Alex Salmond and the SNP ministers were the royal family of the Saudi Arabia of hyperbole rather than anything to do with renewable energy. And I think the debate so far we have had is really about that clash between very warm and grandiose words and the reality that's on the ground. Mr. Colin Smith, I think, has highlighted the divergence between the huge promises were made a decade ago and the challenge for this government in this debate today and more generally is to actually convince the public that they have a sound vision that's pursuable and that it isn't just those grand promises. Because we're still here after 14 years of the climate emergency worsening by the day and all that time wasted on grand words and little work. We're being asked to believe that now that the coalition partners in the Greens who can't produce or run a bottle return scheme are going to be the difference in making that transition work. Frankly, I think that that stretches the credibility even further. So if Scotland is to successfully transition to that low-carbon economy, we have to have a clear industrial plan built with experts, investors, trade unions and workers, and particularly from the oil and gas sector. So my position as a member for North East Scotland, I regularly meet with businesses keen to assist them to create jobs and to make profits in these new industries. Floating offshore wind offers real opportunities for the North East. However, for reasons that I find genuinely difficult to understand, the Scottish Government is putting Scotland at a serious disadvantage in the evolution of an offshore wind supply chain by limiting innovation or stepping stone projects in the North Sea to 100 megawatts, which they have been told quite specifically by the industry will be unfinanceable. So the contrast and the competition is with English and Welsh waters of the Celtic Sea, where innovation projects up to 300 megawatts are able to come forward. So I'm asking ministers for assurance today that they will look at the INTOG plan and think again on these limits. Unless this 100 megawatt cap is raised to 300 million, in 1 second I will, unless this 100 megawatt cap is raised to 300 megawatts for innovation as well as oil and gas linked projects, Scotland will struggle to compete with activity elsewhere in the UK. Yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member raises an important point in relation to INTOG, and it's an issue which we're actively considering at the present moment. However, he'll be aware that the purpose behind the cap is to help to generate innovation and to drive new technology in this particular sector. And the danger is, in lifting the cap to a much greater level, is that you don't drive that innovation and that new technology. And that's part of the reason and part of the thinking that's going on in terms of trying to strike the right balance for the sector.
Michael Mara.
I certainly understand the intent from the Minister in terms of the scale and the need, in his view, for a cap. But if those 100 megawatt projects are unfinanceable and unrealistic, then the kind of innovation that he hopes for won't happen. So I think he has to engage in this, and when we see the revision to the INTOG guidelines, which I believe are underway, then I hope it will reflect the actual reality of making these projects happen. Because I think for far too long, it's the kind of rhetoric about the grand promises that we've had. If we don't develop these stepping stone projects to build the supply chain in advance of ScotWind, otherwise we'll be into the same old cycle of work going overseas. So the decision to raise the INTOG innovation cap is not a matter for Westminster. It rests with the Scottish Government alone. I hope at least that's a practical innovation, a step that can be taken by this Government coming out of this debate today.
Thank you. I call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Tess White. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Ruskell.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, you know, here we are again, Groundhog Day motion on oil and gas coming from the Tories, and it does seem that they're having trouble keeping up with the changing world and the changing nature of this debate. But, you know, let's rewind a bit for the sake of Mr. Kerr and go back to what the world was saying all those months ago in the run-up to COP26. The UN Secretary General said that countries should, and I quote, end all new fossil fuel exploration and production and shift fossil fuel subsidies into renewable energy. That, Mr. Kerr, is about getting real. The International Energy Agency said that if governments are serious about the climate crisis, there can be no new investments in oil, gas and coal from now, from this year. That is about getting real. Lord Deben, who's chair of the UK Climate Change Committee, told Mr. Kerr in this very parliament that the justification for any new oil and gas exploration or production has to be very strong indeed, and I cannot say that I have seen that so far. That is also about getting real. And then, of course, in September, we also had then in September, UK Secretary of State for Energy, Kwasi Kwarteng, say that the way forward was to build a strong homegrown renewable energy sector to further reduce our reliance on fossil fuels in response to the recent gas price crisis. That was also about getting real. If there's time in hand, I'll give way to Mr. Kerr or Mr. Carson, actually.
Mr. Finlay Carson.
Thanks for taking the intervention. When you're talking about getting real, do you welcome the fact that the UK may have to import oil and gas from abroad with a larger footprint to ensure we do have a just transition?
Yeah. Bart Roscoe?
That's exactly the point, Mr. Carson, of what the Scottish Government is now doing to assess what our domestic energy requirements are and how that then relates to the fields that we've got in the North Sea, the 6 billion barrels of oil and gas that we've got in the North Sea, some of which could meet our domestic energy needs. Now, if I can just take Mr. Kerr to November, COP26 and the Glasgow Agreement. In the text of that agreement, there was a welcome recognition of the need for just transition and a recognition of the need to phase out fossil fuel subsidies. But the failure of the agreement to commit to a global phase out of coal was largely due to there being no matching commitment from richer countries to phase out our oil and gas. And it's quite clear that what the world now has to do to keep 1.5 alive, the only responsible way forward globally is a managed transition and phase out of oil and gas over time, rather than a sudden and deferred collapse in the future. And Colin Smith is right to remind the Tories of their unjust transition of coal mining communities in the 1980s, which has left so many generations on the scrap heap. A managed transition is the only way that we can ensure oil and gas workers are not left behind. Yet it's disappointing, I think, to hear the industry continue to make the case for licensing of new reserves. And, you know, Mr. Kerr will have heard yesterday Oil and Gas UK speaking in the Net Zero Committee about how they wanted to upscale from 6 billion barrels in the North Sea to 18 billion barrels in the years ahead, and how maximum economic recovery of this is somehow consistent with both a just transition and the goal of 1.5 degrees. It's no wonder that public polling shows a distrust in the industry to lead its own transition, because we need to see that strategic leadership coming from governments to protect the climate and protect the workers. Presiding officer, we need to work within our planetary limits. This shouldn't be a barrier to innovation and growth of business opportunities, because it's the very catalyst that we need for change, to create new markets, to crowd in investment, and deliver long-term, stable and fair jobs for the future. That's the debate that we'll be having in this chamber. It just looks like the Tories are not interested in having it.
Thank you. I now call Tess White to be followed by Jim Fairley. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. White.
Presiding officer, in the North East, the region I represent, the offshore oil and gas sector is worth more than £18 billion to the local economy. It supports 65,600 jobs. Presiding officer, it may feel like Groundhog Day to Mr. Ruskell, but a fair and managed transition to net zero is critical to these communities. And it's critical to these communities and their economic and emotional well-being. The SNP Green Coalition spends a lot of time talking about just transition, but it's becoming increasingly clear that it simply doesn't understand what it means. We need to see a responsible transition to net zero that takes existing energy demand into account, protects our energy security, and safeguards the jobs of workers in carbon-intensive industries. Last week, Patrick Harvey suggested that it was extreme to keep expanding oil and gas exploration in the North Sea. He seems to have succumbed to the fallacy that cutting off domestic supply somehow means that the demand for fossil fuels will disappear. And no, I won't take an intervention. It won't instead. We'll rely increasingly on imports from countries like Russia and Qatar, losing thousands of jobs for no environmental gain. An odd position for the so-called Greens, when outsourcing oil and gas production overseas ignores the huge carbon footprint of doing so. You might smile at me, Mr. Rusko, but it's not funny. LNG imports from abroad are far more carbon intensive than domestic energy production, more than twice as much. And let's be clear, in all UK Climate Change Committee scenarios, oil and gas accounts for between 47% and 54% of total cumulative energy demand between 2020 and 2050. All of these scenarios are net zero compatible. And let's not forget that the SNP made a second oil boom a central pillar of their economic policies for independence just a few years ago. It's Scotland's oil, they said. Yeah. And that's your narrative. Now, they've cost us the Cambo project and the 1,000 jobs that went with it. Yeah. Astonishingly, the First Minister told MSPs the new oil field shouldn't be given the green light, even before the Scottish Government has completed a programme of work and analysis to understand Scotland's energy requirements. Mm-hmm. How is that credible? This isn't a just transition. For a couple of headlines, the SNP and Greens are recklessly pushing the oil and gas industry over a cliff edge, risking taking countless communities in the northeast with it. And it's shameful. Labour too. Labour would be wise to listen to the GMB's General Secretary's scathing criticism of the cheerleaders for the Cambo shutdown, saying they aren't just throwing energy workers under the bus, but also our security of energy supply for gas we will still need on the road to 2050. And that was the GMB. Presiding officer. No, I'm in the last few minutes. Presiding officer.
Let's chat from a secondary position, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, we all need to recognise that we must take action on climate change. We all recognise that. The energy sector isn't just alive to the climate crisis. It is at the forefront of the low-carbon energy transition. Now, more than ever, we need the skills, expertise, and innovation of this sector to help us achieve net zero. Yep. And yet, this SNP Green coalition, complicit with Labour, are determined to target it. Meanwhile, thousands of hard-working people in the energy sector are getting on with the diversification to renewables that we need for net zero. It's high time the SNP back them and the North East instead of their cosy coalition partners. Thank you.
Thank you. I next call Jim Fairley. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd written a speech already for this debate that was forward-looking, focused and positive. I then read the Tory motion. So, Presiding Officer, just transition. It's a phrase that gets bandied about a lot these days. It's like the newest buzzword that proves you're just not cool if you don't use it. It started off as a genuine phrase with meaning and depth, and it's now just become a political football being kicked around all over the place. And I suppose in politics it were ever thus. Now, I'm old enough to remember, as are most of the people sitting in this chamber, another time when Scotland was promised a new dawn with opportunities in every corner of Britain for those who were prepared to grab them. Then, Ravenscraig Towers came down. The ships stopped being built, the pits were closed, and we stopped making cars. The political choices of Thatcher's years laid waste to huge swathes of communities right across the industrial heartlands of Scotland, all with promises of jam tomorrow. Now, those communities are still waiting for the jam that will never be delivered by the Tories. In fact, their current Westminster leader actually joked about Thatcher being ahead of her time in reaching net zero by closing the coal mines. Now, she may well have been, but her motivation had nothing to do with climate change. It was just another Tory Prime Minister who cared not a jot for the people of Scotland. These hard-working communities were utterly decimated and will still live with the aftermath of the poverty, alcohol abuse, drug abuse and three generations of people who were left to rot. So a Tory motion talking about defending jobs and protecting an industry that doesn't ring true, the hypocrisy is utterly dripping from every word. In fact, the hypocrisy is something there is plenty of from the Tories in here. There is hypocrisy in wanting to suck out every last drop of oil that is left in Scotland's seas, something that simply does not chime with the global reality of our need to stop burning fossil fuels, let alone the government's own targets, the UK government's own targets of reaching net zero by 2050. Now, if the Tories' motivation for wanting to drain every last dollar of oil in the North Sea was really to protect the fabulous workforce and use the revenue for direct benefit for the people of Scotland, I could have some sympathy with the motion, but it's not. It's about bleeding our natural resources dry and siphoning off the money to be swallowed up by Westminster's own vanity projects, while at the same time completely bypassing the democratically elected parliament right here in Scotland. Had there been an oil fund established, as Norway did, for the direct use of this Scottish Government, oh no boy, we could be doing with such a fund right now, Presiding Officer, because let's face it, the Norwegian fund is now up to $1.5 trillion. Then again, I could possibly have sympathy with this motion. But alas, there is nothing. Instead, Westminster won't even talk to the Scottish Government about devolved borrowing powers so we can make the decisions about how we fund what this government needs to manage the devastation of COVID, let alone reduce our carbon emissions, while maintaining world-class workforce in meaningful, well-paid, long-term jobs. And while we're talking about how the vast wealth that has been taken from our seas, what have we actually got to show for it? Well, we've got a fantastic workforce in the northeast, but there had to be, because the oil was based off our coast. We have an infrastructure that can see us into the next stage of the real opportunities to harness the energy from nature. Again, there had to be, because it was needed to get access to our resources. However, the most advanced carbon capture project there is in the UK right now doesn't necessarily have to be in the North East. So guess what? It's not. Sit down. That has been rejected by the UK government in favour of far less advanced projects in England, buying up red wall votes that they gained in the last election. So much for this Tory motion supposed to be commitment to the folk of the North East. Acorn has been buried, and the only way that that project is going to grow its full potential is when Scotland is an independent country with all the powers we need to absolutely maximise every opportunity that our vast wealth and resources offer us. Only then will the people of Scotland get the true benefit of all of Scotland's natural resources. We talk in Parliament code about the three-lined whips. Today's motion from the Tories is nothing more than a whinge, and that is probably the biggest letdown to the North East energy sector of the lot. They are offering nothing, they are suggesting nothing, and frankly, they don't want to change anything. The government's amendment, on the other hand, talks in detail about the challenges we face, the number of workers that need to be supported, the timescales that are involved, and the amount of money, almost £500 million, that will form an actual just transition for the North East and Murray. And I know where I'll be voting tonight. I'm finished.
Thank you. And I now call Jackie Dunbar, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Dunbar. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have the opportunity again to speak to this motion. I feel a bit like deja vu because I kind of spoke about this last week in the Just Transition debate. I'm probably going to use some of my words from last week, Presiding Officer, so please forgive me. It's no surprise that the North East has relied on the oil and gas industry for many years to provide vital jobs and investments in the region, and as a result, it has flourished. My own family, Presiding Officer, has been brought up with the money that has been earned through the oil and gas industry. My other half has worked in it most of his life, and my daughter is now an OT engineer who spends an awful lot of time on the oil rigs doing her work. Don't I quite ask me exactly what it is she does, because she's a lot brainier than what I ever will be. Yes, I'll take an intervention, Mr.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the member for giving way. So obviously she understands the importance of the oil and gas industry. So does she not agree with me that projects like Cambo need to go ahead for the prosperity of the North East?
Jackie Dunbar.
It was Shell that has put the kibosh on Cambo, is my understanding. But what I do find, and it's a pity we can't agree that what we're trying to do here, Presiding Officer, through you, is to actually protect the jobs in the North East. And that is what I am doing, instead of trying to make shameful statements to try and scare the folk of the North East into believing that we are shutting down the oil rigs tomorrow. That is just an absolute disgrace, and I am getting sick and tired of hearing it every day. We at the NZ committee yesterday heard from Professor Hazeldine, who was absolutely brilliant. He was discussing with us why Acorn was not selected. And some of it, I thought, was just absolutely spot on. And it might actually come as a surprise to some. I'm going to read a paragraph, if you don't mind, Presiding Officer, from him. Acorn has long been recognised as being the best investigated and most mature of all the UK decarbonisation clusters. It is also low risk because the pipelines exist. The storage site is very well investigated and minimal new infrastructure is needed. Acorn also opens up access to 80% of the geological storage around the UK of many diverse geological types, providing the highest chance of developing secure storage geology. Sorry, my teeth needn't put back in. And Acorn can rapidly develop supplies of CO2 by shipping from sources across the UK. This was not taken into the factor when they were looking at the contracts. The Acorn development is huge for us, and it is huge for going forward for the just transition. So for the UK government to put it on reserve, to make sure that means that the companies, Presiding Officer, who are developing the stuff in the Acorn, and I am no expert, but I was told yesterday that they're having to carry on investigating the new technologies and the new ways of doing things, but have got no... I'm sorry, I'm just a way to finish. I've got 20 seconds. And they've got no way of getting recompense for that money because it's on a reserve list and there is no guarantee that Acorn is going to come on board. That is what is shameful, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We will now move to closing speeches, and I call on Michael Mara to wind up for Labour. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Talk about deja vu. Here I am again. We have had versions of this debate, I think, over recent weeks, and I actually don't share some of the members of the Chamber's regret about that. I see there's no more important economic issue that this country faces, and we should be discussing this time and again in this Chamber. We should be talking about practical interventions that the government should be taking, and I'd be happy to talk about it as often as we possibly can, because there's nothing, as I began my own speech by saying, more important to my region, and frankly, I believe the whole country, in doing something about this transition and doing it properly. I'm afraid in this short debate, the government, I think, have maintained the position of being heavy on rhetoric and light on realistic and reality-based solutions. We have to have a government that's engaged, actually less in issues of grievance than actually trying to bring forward solutions, working with other governments, both in this country and abroad, to try and help deal with this situation and to bring opportunity to the country. So when the Minister is very keen to highlight the Acorn project, I'm afraid, as various SNP members on the benches have done, it's very much in a tone of grievance. But we know that carbon capture is absolutely vital to the statutory targets that we've been set in this Parliament that was voted through by and is meant to be adopted by this government. And if there isn't a solution on the table right now, from the current process, then it's up to this government to find a different way of creating a process, finding capital in international markets, finding investors, working with partners to actually make this happen. Now, I absolutely agree that in terms of how the setback that the refusal of the Track 1 status for the carbon capture project in the North East has been. But the reality is that a solution has to be found. And when I asked the Minister a few weeks ago how many times he had met with the UK government to actually pursue this issue, he told me at that time he'd met with them at least two or three times. It turns out he's actually not met them at all to pursue this. Well, I'm afraid on freedom of information request from your diary, it is absolutely confirmed that no such meetings took place, and I can provide, I certainly can.
Cabinet Secretary?
Off the top of my head, the very day before the UK government made its announcement, I had a call with Greg Hands and raised the very issue of the Scottish cluster with him and whether, when they announced their net zero strategy, whether he would announce the outcome of that, given the importance of it to the Scottish economy. So there you go. There's one very good example of exactly when I discussed the matter with the UK government.
Michael Marr, I get to reintroduce you to the debate. Michael Marr, thank you.
Thank you. Apologies, Presiding Officer. I'd be very happy to provide the Freedom of Information request to the Minister that actually details his diary over that period, that actually shows that no such meetings, as he detailed, actually were in the diary. I'm assuming that there will be notes available from those meetings if he believes that they actually took place. So we actually need a government that's going to be able to walk the walk rather than just talk the talk. And this Parliament has to be, in the words when Paul McLennan said, who is letting Scotland down? It's the job of this government and this Parliament to lift Scotland up and to find solutions rather than finding a conflict at every turn. And I think we do have to get practical. So and the practical things introduced from these benches and talking about lifting the cap on offshore wind innovation projects, what could be done about that? And I'd like to hear a response from the Minister in his closing speech on that. And perhaps a move to monthly auctions for offshore wind licences to actually build the pipeline and stimulate more companies that can actually develop different products bi-yearly auctions on offshore licences isn't actually stimulating the throughput in the pipeline, and port directors around Scotland have highlighted that to me in recent weeks. And we also need to look at increasing domestic content. The UK government introduced a contract this week which had no requirements for domestic content, whereas the US government is introducing 55% limits on that. So there's lots that we can all do. We need to get real about this, and we need to get deeply practical. So the more times we can discuss it, the more times we can move away from the conflict and rhetoric that's brought to the chamber by lots of members, the better, because actually the jobs in the North East and the future of the Scottish economy depend on it.
Thank you. I now call on Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary, to wind up the Scottish Government. Up to 5 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like others, I very much welcome a debate that is on such an important sector to the Scottish economy, given the important role which it will play in helping to support and sustain economic transition and an energy transition in Scotland. My view is that, and the Scottish Government's view is, that the skills and the assets of our oil and gas sector in Scotland are a strength in that transition, helping to support the move towards low-carbon energies, which will serve us in the years ahead. And I think Colin Smith was right in his contribution when he said we are operating on borrowed time. Because the backdrop to all of this debate is that it is in the face of the twin crises of a climate crisis and biodiversity crisis that we need to make sure that the actions we take on energy policy in the years ahead are reflective of the global climate change challenge which we all face. There are maybe different views within this chamber on how we should do that, the pace at which it should be taken forward and the manner in which it should be taken forward. But I actually believe that there is no one in this chamber, no one in this chamber, that doesn't recognise that we need to deliver a just transition for those who are employed in our oil and gas sector and those who are dependent upon our oil and gas sector. Those of us in this chamber who are old enough to have lived through the economic and social and community disaster that was created by the closure of our mining communities and our pits and by the closure of our steel mills, given the impact they had, which is now intergenerational, we cannot, and no government should allow that to be repeated. And one thing this government will not do is stand aside and allow such a repeat of failure in terms of government to actually do so. I'll give way to Mr. Kerr.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Last week, Gary Smith of the GMB said that workers have been lied to because the Scottish Government have been talking about and promising tens of thousands of jobs in the renewable sector, and these jobs have never materialised. Was he right?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I don't think he is, but I understand that he has a view on energy policy which is not consistent with that of the Scottish Government. For example, his view on nuclear energy is not consistent with the Scottish Government. He would like to see more nuclear energy, and we are not supportive of that. But I recognise that there is more that we need to do in order to grow and to develop our renewable energy sector. I made reference to a very good example of that just in the course of the last week with the new factory that's been developed at Nigg, a very good practical example of a facility which has largely been used for oil and gas purposes, being converted and becoming and transitioning towards an important facility in helping to support the transition to renewable energy. And I want to pick up on the point that a number of members have made in terms of growing and developing our offshore energy sector, particularly in the renewable energy elements of it. The member will be aware that, in particular Colin Smith's contribution, that we are presently going through the ScotWind Round process, which is looking at the leasing of the seabed in a number of different parts across Scottish waters. And within that, for the first time, because this is the first time we've had a leasing programme, previously it was a matter which was controlled by the Crown Estate at a UK government level. But now that we've got devolved competence on it, we're actually making sure, embedded in that process, there is a clear statement of intent on how those who secure leases will be able to support the domestic supply chain. And I actually believe we're starting to see that materialising in the decision that was announced in NIG just last week. But do we need to develop that and grow that further? Absolutely. And we need to make sure we capitalise on that. And I want to pick up on Michael Mara's point around the NTOG process. It's out to consultation, but it is important here that we do not let the oil and gas industry off the hook, and those who are in innovative businesses that are looking to develop technology that could help to decarbonise oil and gas facilities at sea through the use of renewable energy by simply lifting the cap to a level that actually compromises the ability to do that. I hear those in the industry would say that we should just do what the UK government is doing. There may be merit in doing that. I am not ruling that out. But I also don't want to simply remove the challenge to the oil and gas sector and to those who are in the renewable sector to make sure that we're supporting innovation, but also making sure that they decarbonise their operations. And I think we need to make sure that we listen to those views, but that we do not simply back away from challenging them as well in this process. But we'll take those views into account, and I'll undertake to write to Mr. Mara with more details around how we're going to consider that as part of the consultation, if that would be helpful to him. Can I also, Signed Officer, turn finally to the issue around the importance of the Scottish cluster? No one should be in any doubt about the absolute critical importance that the Scottish cluster plays to not just the decarbonisation of key parts of the Scottish industry within oil and gas, but also to meeting our climate change targets. The UK government will not be able to achieve its own climate change targets without the Scottish cluster. The reality is that if we are to deliver a just transition for our oil and gas industry, all governments need to play their part. And that includes the UK government playing their part in supporting the cluster and moving it into track one. In doing that, they will start to demonstrate the ambition and the leadership that's necessary to make sure we deliver for the northeast of Scotland, for the oil and gas sector, and in dealing with our climate change targets. I believe that there is a good future for our oil and gas sector here in Scotland, and also in supporting us moving to low-carbon energies. And the Scottish Government will be doing everything in its control in order to make sure we deliver on that vision in the future.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I now call Douglas Lumsden to wind up the debate for the Conservatives. And I would say that you would have 7 minutes in light of the fact the Cabinet Secretary had six.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's telling when it comes to defending the thousands of jobs in the North East that it's the Scottish Conservatives who bring forward this debate, because every other party seems to have abandoned the energy industry. And I offer no apologies to Mike Ruskell or Jackie Dunbar for bringing this debate again today, because we will bring this forward any time to defend the thousands of jobs that are at stake in the North East. The Conservative Group are 100% behind a transition towards net zero. There is no doubt and no question about that commitment. But we believe in just that, a transition, no cliff edge, no immediate stop to oil and gas production, no uncertainty for workers, and a coherent plan to protect the North East. At the moment, this SNP Green coalition has no plan. It's creating a huge amount of anxiety in my area and is threatening the oil and gas industry with a cliff edge that could harm us all. Their approach is putting tens of thousands of North East jobs at risk, and will have a devastating impact on the economy of not just the North East, but Scotland as a whole. And that brings me on to some of the contributions we've heard today. Liam Kerr quite rightly mentioned Russia, Qatar and Norway, who will be looking on gleefully as the First Minister shoots herself in the foot and strengthens jobs and the economy in those areas. Paul McClellan asked twice, who is supporting Acorn? Well, I can tell him because he wouldn't take an intervention, but the UK are supporting Acorn to the tune of £31 million so far. Jackie Dunbar, that is real support. Nothing, I believe, from the Scottish Government. I also heard from the Cabinet Secretary. You know, he spoke once again about the £500 million transition fund. In the budget last week, we heard £20 million of capital funding, but as yet we do not know if companies have to bid in, is there projects in the pipeline? Absolutely no details whatsoever. And Liam MacArthur rightly points out the importance of jobs and retraining, but once again mentioned the lack of details on the transition fund. And it's not just here that the debate is taking place. Others are having a say outside this chamber. Former SNP First Minister Alex Salmon said at the weekend that the SNP has kicked the North East in the teeth. He gets it. Union leaders get it. John Boland from Unite and Jake Molloy of RMT all spoke of their fears after hearing the news that Shell had withdrawn from Cambo. And they're right to be worried. I sit on the Finance Committee and witness after witness gives evidence that shows our economy is in serious trouble. And much of it is driven by this coalition with the Greens pulling the strings. Our tax intake per person is lower than the rest of the UK and getting worse. Our welfare bill is rising faster than the rest of the UK. Our working population is falling compared to the rest of the UK. Economic growth lower than the rest of the UK. Recovery slower than the rest of the UK. Complete incompetence by this devolved Scottish Government, and it's an absolute disgrace. We cannot simply throw this industry over the cliff edge and expect our economy to weather it. It won't. There are significant consequences that this devolved government and the coalition partners fail to acknowledge or address. Transition means just that, a steady and progressive move from the large-scale production in the North East to a more balanced picture between renewables and oil and gas. But we have to be realistic and we have to take account of all our responsibilities. As a parliament, we have to consider all aspects of the transition from oil and gas, whether the oil and gas that we still need, and we need to know where it comes from. We cannot simply import from other countries that have weaker environmental standards than we do. That would be counterproductive. That would be irresponsible. A transition has to include ensuring that we have adequate resources at home to ensure our citizens can stay warm without relying on imported oil and gas at increased cost to our pockets, our workforce, and to our global environment. A transition means moving towards renewables quickly, but in a managed and structured way, protecting jobs, livelihoods, and the economy. Some of the statements from the SNP Green Coalition have been very disturbing. Liam Kerr mentioned it earlier, and Sir Ian Wood also commented last week, saying that politicians should reflect carefully on their public statements on oil and gas. Yes, I will.
Stephen Kerr.
How embarrassed must the SNP be that they bring the Green Minister into this chamber to listen to this debate, but don't let him speak?
Douglas Lumsden.
It's actually probably a good thing that we don't hear him speak, but I'm glad he is here because I want him to address something later in my speech. Yes, please do.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. How embarrassed must the Conservatives be that they still, not necessarily here, but at Westminster, still select as candidates, as politicians, outright climate deniers, people who've now moved on from supporting Brexit to opposing lockdown and are now forming the Net Zero Scrutiny Group to try and oppose climate action UK-wide. How embarrassed are the Tories about that?
Douglas Lumsden.
I think the most embarrassing thing is that we have a Scottish minister with language like that and being put in charge. Unbelievable. So, as Ian Wood also commented last week, saying that politicians should reflect carefully on their public statements on oil and gas and the impact they have on the investment in the industry. Maybe something that's the minister should take note of. He added, we must not create an adverse investment environment at this crucial moment in our energy transition journey. The future prosperity of our region and the country's ability to meet net zero depends on it. And, Presiding Officer, I would draw attention to the comments of the Green Minister, Patrick Harvey, joining us today, calling supporters of oil and gas in the North East far right. Those were shocking statements, Presiding Officer, and call into question his ability to serve as a government minister. Only a few hours later...
Mr Lumsden, sorry, point of order, Mr Harvey, Patrick Harvey.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. I suspect the member knows that I did not use the words far right. I suspect he's very well aware that he's misleading the chamber. If my suspicion is wrong, I will apologise for that. But if he's aware that he's using words I didn't use, and that I use the words hard right to describe him and his party, not anybody else, then I suspect he should withdraw his comments.
Mr Harvey will be aware that the content of members' contributions is not a matter for me, and therefore is not a point of order, but a mechanism exists by which members can correct their contributions. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Only a few hours later, my constituency office was vandalised with swastikas spray-painted on the door and windows. The police are treating this as a hate crime, and I'm not trying to tell the police how to do their job, but maybe they should be considering that it was maybe a member of this parliament that instigated that attack.
Mr Lumsden, can I ask you to please conclude your remarks as we're over time?
Thank you. This debate, it is shameful. Your language is shameful. This debate is an opportunity for all parties to agree that we need to transition away from oil and gas in a sensible and sustainable way, but without throwing thousands of North East jobs under the bus. The damage being caused
by
the comments from
Mr.
the police,
Lumsden.
Heartbroken. Presiding Officer, this debate today is our opportunity to send the message that the North East of Scotland is open for business. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on backing the North East economy. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. Point of order, Stephen Kerr.
Presiding Officer, given the technical problems that surround the use of blue jeans today and the decision to perhaps defer votes to another day, particularly tomorrow, can the Presiding Officer shed some light on when exactly those votes might be held during the course of tomorrow's business?
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I cannot at this moment. The situation is currently being further investigated and will update the Chamber as soon as possible. Thank you. Can I take point of order, Martin Whitfield?
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. Due to the technical difficulties that have already been referred to, one of the speeches from these benches would have come remotely, and I would ask for your indulgence to allow me to submit that speech on behalf of Claire Baker, MSP, during this debate.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield, and certainly. Can I just take this moment to remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus.